So can you guys see my screen?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, so let's dive right in. So like I said, it's short. Okay. Every other thing that we are supposed to do, the important part, I won't say the important part, the bulk of the work has been done in the first maybe 5-6 weeks, because that's where you are doing a lot of thinking and brainstorming and like the rest is now more or less aesthetics. And I don't mean that typography, color, and maybe the other principles are not important. They are, because at the end of the day, that's what, you know, the user sees. That's what the user sees. So we did research so we can really understand, or you know, more or less understand the problem we're trying to solve. Okay, that we probably understand the user as a whole. So we did typography on Thursday, and we've learned how type, like type and color, are part of the design fundamentals or UI fundamentals. So I started with those two because they are more or less what stands out the most from the bucket of or the category of UI fundamentals. So next week Thursday we'll touch on the other fundamentals, because they are not, they are important, you know, or they are quick things you can easily bring in. But typography and color stand out because most of the times this is where many people, even professionals, make mistakes a lot. You know, we did type on Thursday, so today we're doing color. So today we'll understand what color theory is. We'll talk about different terminologies in color, and then we'll learn how to, and we'll find resources, we'll give you resources and tools which you can, you know, get color palettes and, you know, generate colors from, you know, using this color theory that we'll learn. A lot of things are easier, like I said, just like type, you know, before you had to stress yourself about it. Now we have boundaries for it. The same thing applies to color, okay? Before you would have to, I don't mean, if you take it seriously, at the end of the day, you can end up generating your own unique color palettes and the likes. Okay, it takes time, but for a beginner, you can always use these tools, you can always use these resources, you know, to easily get color palettes that you can work with your design. Okay, so let's dive right in and let's begin for today. So what is color? Okay, there's no, how do I put this? There's no certain way of me defining what color is, because everyone already knows what color is. Okay. Color is more or less like a component of light, you know, which is separated when it is reflected off of an object. Okay. You know, I think some of our science students, we know about the glass prism test, when light touches something and then brings it into the colors of the rainbow. Okay. So there is really no definite way of defining color. What people just say is color is an example of a color. Okay? Color is blue, color is yellow. Color in of itself is majorly self-explanatory. Okay? You are looking at the screen now, you can see the background color is black. Okay, so we just know it's something that is a component of light. Okay, that's like the main definition or a simpler definition. It's like a component of light, you know, which when it's, you know, separated, it's reflected upon an object. Let me not dwell too much on it because there's really no need to find out what color is. So let's quickly talk about color wheel, okay? Now, the color wheel is more or less a way to show relationship between colors, you know, and the color wheel shows links between different colors, you know, based on the primary colors, which is red, yellow, and blue. Okay. Those are our primary colors. So every other thing is sort of derived from the primary colors at the end of the day. You know, and the first color wheel was developed by Sir Isaac Newton in the year 1666. Okay. So some people Rainbow Six 3-6 is there and they start going crazy. But it was first developed by Isaac Newton in the year 1666. And it sort of states that colors can be categorized into groups. Okay. Okay. Sorry about that. Okay. So color wheel can be categorized into three major types. Okay. So let me touch on the categorizations. Okay, and we have primary colors, which is your red, your blue, and your yellow. Okay. Because this is the basis of every single color you would ever make or you would ever create. Okay. When you go beyond this, you now have the secondary colors, which comprises both the primary and the secondary, you know, colors. And it's secondary colors are made by mixing two primary colors. Okay. So where we have yellow and red creates orange. Okay. And then we have blue and yellow creating green. Okay. No, that sort of thing. And mixing blue and red creates purple. Okay? So that's where we get the secondary colors from. So the third categorization will be tertiary colors, and they are created by mixing both primary and secondary colors. You get, so it goes on. Okay. That's why the initial picture of the color wheel is like this. Okay. So you know, tertiary colors now comes in when you mix in both primary and secondary colors. Okay. So that's when we can now see if yellow green will give you something, and then a red purple will give you, you know. So that's majorly categorization of, you know, the color wheel as a whole. Now, a thorough understanding of the color wheel and the relationship between colors, you know, sort of enables designers to understand color better. Okay. So it sort of helps you to know how to choose colors, okay? But just knowing what makes up primary colors or what makes up secondary colors or tertiary colors is not enough, okay? So which is why we'll talk about achieving harmony, okay? So how do you achieve harmony? How do you select colors? How do you, you know, make sure that your design stands out color-wise, okay? Now remember, just like how we talked about type, colors have express emotions as well. Okay, so I think I'll link an article in the classroom on what each color represents. Okay, so you can read up on that. You know, now the same thing applies here to color. You know, if you are maybe designing something for a food related website, you won't go for, you know, some certain colors. Okay, you go with colors like maybe red or orange. You know, those provoke hunger, sort of, you know. If you are going for a sophisticated design, you would go with maybe black and white, you know, to exhibit elegance and those kinds of things, or simplicity. So color has a way of, you know, your brand, color has a way of depicting that brand or that product, you know, which is why it's also important to note that. But when, you know, you have to pick color, okay, when you have to, you know, create this harmonious feel of colors for your design, how do you go, you know, about it? So color should more or less be chosen to deliver an experience, you know, a better user experience to the user. Okay, that means it's more or less like a good idea, you know, to think about what color scheme you would use, okay, before you begin the design process. Okay, now I won't say the design process, before you begin, you know, finalizing the design, more or less. You know, we talked about wireframes and we said there are two types of wireframes. We have the low fidelity wireframes and we have the high fidelity. You know, so when you are at that stage of your high fidelity, you are done, you already know how every element works, you already know everything is, that is where you now bring in color. Okay, that is when you now start saying, oh, okay, this is how it should look like. This color would play better with this kind of feel. Okay, I'm working on a website for KFC. Okay, I need to use red. I need to provoke hunger, you know, but it's more or less now looking, oh, it can be red all through. You know, that is where we come up with color schemes. Because fine, there's a scheme, a monochromatic scheme that gives you one color, you know, but it depends on what you are going for. Okay, so let's just dive right into the schemes. The first one is the monochromatic scheme. So this is the first scheme for selecting colors. Okay, and the monochromatic scheme is based on one color created from different tints, okay, or tones and shades of one hue. Okay, now hue simply means color. Okay, it's just a term, another word for color. So hue just determines the value of a color from 0 to, I think, 309? I'm not sure. It's 300 and something. I can't remember the value, you know. But hue is simply a color. So when we're working with a monochromatic scheme, it means we're picking one color. So let's say our base color is blue or red, you know. And we're now adding tints, or we're adding tones to it. So tints means you're adding white, tones means you're adding black to it. So when you tint it, it becomes, you know, lighter, but it's still that same color. And when you tone it, it becomes darker, but it's still that same color. So a lot of brands that have a very strong color, a very strong, you know, very dominant color like red, or a very dominant color like, you know, maybe purple, okay? No, those majorly warm colors, okay? So warm colors, like, you know, the primary colors, that's yellow, red, and blue, you know, you would majorly play well with monochromatic schemes. That doesn't mean other colors won't play well with it, okay? It's more or less about applying these different schemes to picking color. So the monochromatic scheme is simply just one color, meaning you are using one color throughout your design, but you are varying it by making it lighter and making it darker, and you know, making it, you know, have that feel of one color, because it's more like using type from one typeface, using fonts from one typeface. Okay, it's more or less the same thing. It's one color, but you are now varying it by, you know, making it lighter or making it darker. Okay, so let me see if I can. Okay. Let me pull up Figma. I think we'll just, you know, as we work with those color schemes, I'll show you. So let's quickly create a frame, and then if we say we're doing a monochromatic scheme, you know, let's make the first box. Okay, then we have a second, you know, and let's say we have a third. Okay, let me pick my frame again, stretch it out a little. So, you know, let's say we're going with this purple here. Okay, if I pick this, this is more or less our, you know, our value, our, you know, and if you look at the color swatch here, it's still the same thing. Okay, still the same thing. But if I come in here now and I say, let me sample this. Okay, it's still the same color. But if I'm using the monochromatic scheme now, I would come into the hex value and I can, you know, drop this down to give or take 75. It's still the same color, okay? I come in here, I sample the other color, and then I'm dropping this to, let's say 60, okay? This is more or less what a monochromatic scheme is. So it's more or less, it's the same color, but, you know, I'm changing the hue, you know, and the value of the tints or the tones, you know, to give me that feel. So I can now use this as one color swatch for my design. Believe me, I've done some designs where it's just one color and it turned out well, you know. So this is one of the powerful things that the monochromatic scheme can actually give you. So let's just go back, yeah. So the other color scheme is the analogous color scheme. So it's majorly where colors is based on three colors that are, you know, next to each other on the color scheme, on the color wheel rather. Okay. So here we have, you know, blue, we have cyan, and then we have that should be more or less violet. Okay. You know, so it's you know, when you pair three colors that are side by side, okay, on the color scheme, on the color wheel rather, you know, So this scheme tends to work well with, you know, when you're creating maybe gradients, or you know, you have this design where everything has to look similar or look familiar. Okay, that is when you would use, you know, this color scheme. Okay, so again, I think we should dive into Figma again and let's try out the analogous scheme. So I might say, oh, I want to create another color scheme with, you know, the analogous rule. So I can come in and I can say, okay, we have our purple sort of. So you can actually even use this, because this what do they call it now? The color picker, okay, or selector in Figma works in that light of the colors, you know, the color wheel. Because if you look at it, starts at red, ends at red. So it follows that scheme, you know, sort of. So I'm cool with my purple, okay? And then I... I'm just trying to make it big so you guys can more or less see it. Okay. Okay. So I'm cool with my purple, and what's really next to it? So I can either go left or go right, okay? Or let's say I want to go left. I pick this other blue, okay? And I'm already on the blue, so let me select the blue. You know, and then, oh, I go further left. You know, this is more or less an analogous scheme, okay? You know, so these are majorly three colors that are close to each other on, you know, the wheel. So with this, you can actually play around with this and, you know, use it to create, you know, something unique, something fun within your design. Okay. So that's majorly the analogous scheme. Okay. So the next scheme is maybe I'll just put this here, is the complementary scheme. Okay. So the complementary scheme is majorly colors that are opposite each other. Okay. Opposite each other on the color wheel, you know. Now this I won't say you are bounded by these rules entirely. Some people go ahead and pair one and two rules together and form something unique, okay? But sometimes these rules just are like standards, they just work, okay, which is a very good way of you selecting color. So the complementary color scheme is majorly when two pairs of colors are combined, okay? And sometimes people tend to say these are colors that cancel each other out because they are way, way opposite each other, you know, and it tends to work most of the times, okay? You know, if you look closely at it now, we have the purple and the yellow, okay? When you pair these two together, it's a very wonderful combo. It works really nicely. So the next scheme is a split complementary, okay? So don't get carried away with these terms. They are pretty much straightforward, okay? Most times I find myself using the first three, okay? Because when it now comes to the split complementary, the triadic and the other ones, you know, it gets complex, but there are products which you will actually use them for, okay? There are products that will want variation. Some even go as far as 6-7 colors. Okay. You know, so there's no standard rule. In type, we can say maximum 3, but for colors, you can't really say much because, you know, it's subjective. Okay. But in most cases, you would find people who would say 2-3 colors. Okay. So split complementary is a combination of using complementary color scheme. Okay. You know, and the analogous color scheme, okay? So that's where you have this kind of, you know, triangle that is, you know, long sort of, you know. So why it's a combination of the complementary and the analogous scheme is because if you look closely, you know, the two elements or the two colors rather, that are being selected are almost related, okay? They are close to each other, but they are separated by one hue, okay? So it's like when you look at the triadic here, and then we have 1, 2, 3, okay? For, and when we look at the analogous here, we have 1, 2, 3, you know. But when you look at the triad and the split complementary, rather, you know, you sort of have the same hue, but you are skipping one hue, and then you are picking the two close hues and then drawing down at the center of those two to create your split complementary. Okay. Split complementary is also, it's also a very nice scheme as well. Okay. Then we have triadic. The triadic is when we, when three colors are equal at equal distance with each other. Okay. So in most cases, we use an equilateral triangle to, you know, to create that. So if you look closely, you can actually count 1, 2, 3. Okay. Before this, 1, 2, 3. Before this, and 1, 2, 3. Before this, you know. So they're at equal distance, you know, using an equilateral triangle. You know, that's what the triadic scheme is. And the triadic scheme is actually not bad. You know, it's actually all these schemes are, you know, they have their use cases. Okay, you know, but most times it's more or less about you playing around with those schemes and coming up with unique colors. You know. So the sixth one is the tetradic scheme, okay? Okay, so the tetradic scheme utilizes two sets of complementary pairs, you know, of complementary pairs, which would equal four colors, okay? So just like the split complementary, you have it, you're jumping a hue, and then you're repeating the same thing, you know, diagonally, you know? So it's yellow, then orange, we're skipping this hue here, and then we have blue, and then we're skipping that purple, and then we're getting purple, you know. So it's you know, this scheme is used a lot for, I think, mostly character, this and then the square scheme are used mostly for character design, animation, and the likes. You know, it plays really well with that, you know. And then we have the square scheme, okay, and this is the final color scheme, okay, and the square scheme is a variant of the, you know, the tetradic scheme, okay. Instead of choosing two complementary pairs, this, you know, this square scheme, okay, uses all four corners, and it's just like the, what do they call it again, you know, the triadic, okay. So it's still equal spacing amongst them, but it's now four colors instead of three colors. You know? So it's more or less a way for you to generate more colors. Okay, you know. So if you notice, the analogous is one, other one is three, and then the complementary is two. Split complementary is three. The triadic is three. The tetradic is four. The square is also four. You know. So it just goes on, you know, like that. But these are the seven major color schemes. You can use any of them to generate, you know, whatever type of color you are looking for, you know. But sometimes there are particular colors, you know, which you already know would work, which is why you do some sort of research. So let's talk quickly on color temperature, okay? So color can be used to convey emotions, okay? Like we've said already, you know, you can, you know, assist how a person would feel about your website. So, you know, more or less how you would move them to use your product or how you move them to interact with your product, okay? So, you know, color has more or less that power to do so, okay? Color has more or less has the power to do things, you know, of that nature. But it's also nice to note that different cultures, different backgrounds, different traditions perceive color in different ways, okay? So which is why your research is very, very, very important, okay? Which is why we started the training based on research, because, you know, some cultures, I think in China, red is, you know, commonly used, you know, to represent happiness and prosperity, okay? You know, but white is considered for funerals and misfortune. Okay, so you know, if you know, there are things you may not be able to create using white, you know, or things you won't be able to create using, you know, the color red, because you are not conveying the right message in that region. Okay, you know, so it's more or less you doing research fully, because now you might come across, you know, a product and you are, you know, for example, in Greece now, Greece sees yellow as a notion of sadness, okay? You know, while red is also sadness in places like South Africa. Okay, so color is a very, very big issue, okay? You know, that's why I said there's no size fits all for color, okay? It's a very big issue in how people from different parts of the world relate to your product, okay? You know, because every culture has a way of what they think about certain colors, you know? So it's which is why I'm bringing this up still. It's very important to do your research, okay? Because sometimes your product is good, typography is good, everything is well arranged, alignment is there, balance is there, good proximity is there, you know, but your color is off because your color is not depicting that message, okay? So while red might signify danger here, you know, red might signify something else in another, you know. So if I say delete your account and it's showing red, in China, they're like, why should I delete something that is bringing good luck to me? You know, I hope you get the point, you know. So it's you know, something to look out for. So let's look at color temperature, okay? So we have warm colors. So warm colors are located on the half of the color wheel that includes yellow, orange, and red, okay? So those are your primary colors, you know, and they are said to reflect feelings such as passion, power, happiness, and energy. Okay, so you know, those are what warm colors, you know, reflect. So those warm colors sort of give out this vibe of, you know, liveliness, you know, something is happening, there's action, sort of. So we have cool colors. These are located on the other side of the color wheel, which includes your green, blue, and purple. Okay, so those are like your secondary colors, and they are said to reflect calmness, meditation, and, you know, soothing impressions. So if you creating maybe a meditation app, or you're creating this kind of financial app that you want people to feel trusted, you know, you go with blues, you go with greens, you go with purples, you know, those are cool colors. You can always do a quick Google search and you can get a full spectrum of cool colors, a full spectrum of warm colors. Then we have neutral colors. So these are said to reflect, and I said not to, you know, more or less reflect no emotion, okay, you know, or any particular emotion, okay. They include gray, brown, white, and black. So you would find this, you know, as just neutral colors that tend to work well with other colors as well. So the way you more or less categorize your colors will depend on what you are trying to achieve with your website or with your app, or, you know. So that's why I said, you know, at the end of the day, do your research. Your research is always very, very important, okay? Because your research will inform what you are going for. If you are going for a design of maybe luxury or a luxurious hotel, you will want to pick one or two neutral colors, you know, and maybe pair it with a cool color and one warm color. So it doesn't matter, you know, whichever way you want to go around it. The color scheme is there to help you, you know, but you are not limited to just the color scheme, because sometimes it's more or less about how these colors will work well with each other. Okay, so let's dive right into the, I think this should be like the final part. So we'll just talk about these color terminologies, and then, you know, we should be able to end today's class. Okay, so these are the terminologies we'll be talking about. There are more, okay, there are more than this, but, you know, let's just talk about this. These ones seem to be much more dominant, or the ones you will find yourself, you know, interacting with the most. So brightness is the first one. Brightness refers to how much white or black, okay, is mixed, you know, in the color. So some of them are interwoven, sort of, so they are more or less related, okay? So when brightness is increased to 100, it means, you know, there's only white. You know, if saturation is also zero, it means that the color is not bright as well. So brightness is just simply how much white or black you have in your color. Okay, you know, so it's more or less what we did here when we took this color and then you know we came in here and then you know specified how much you know, white is in it or how much black is in it. So if I pull it downwards here now, it's still the same color. Notice I'm still on the same line, okay? But you know, as I go downwards, it's still the same color, but there's you know more or less more black in the color than before. So this is also more or less your tint and your. You know, if I bring it downwards, this is more or less my tint. Okay, yeah, this is more my tone. Okay, if I take it upwards, it's more or less my tint. Okay, because I'm adding white to it, it becomes brighter. I'm going downwards, becoming darker. You know. So, you know, because if I go all the way down, I now get zero. Okay, that's pure black, even though there's really nothing like you know, pure black. So, second one is CMYK. So CMYK stands for cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. Okay, you know CMYK is based on the primary colors you know that we have. Okay, so it's more or less used for printing. Okay, so it's another important thing to note. CMYK is used for printing. So I would be shocked. I won't say shocked. Yeah, I said I'll be shocked if Figma has the option. So it's not here, but you would find CMYKs in majorly things like Illustrator, InDesign, CorelDRAW, you know, it's more or less for people who do print work, okay? It's still the same color spectrum, you know, but, you know, it now works in values of percentages, okay? You know, so if you are doing design for print, it's always advisable to go with CMYK. So we have a color palette as the next term. So a palette is in the digital world refers to a full range of colors, okay, that you know can be displayed on a device, screen, or an interface. Okay. So a color palette will just be like more or less a selection of colors, you know, a full range of colors which you will be using. So if I bring these guys together, okay, and I say these are the colors I'm working with. This design, yeah. Let me come in here and let me still go further and pull up something else. Okay, let me skip one color. Okay, this is more or less a color palette, right? So this is what a palette would look like. It's a selection of colors, you know, of particular colors that you want to use, you know, for you know that design project. You know, so it's always advisable that after you've done your high fidelity wireframes and the likes, you come here and then you create your palette and then when you are ready to work, this is like a base for you to now start coloring your work, sort of, you know. So the next one is hex. So hex is one of the most commonly used terms in web, okay? You know, in web design or in web colors generally. You know, so it's more or less a six digit hexadecimal number, you know, used to represent colors. Okay, so if I come back here and then I click here, this is more or less the hex value. Okay, so I think it starts from A to F and 0 to 7. So you know, it starts from A to F. So that pairing of those hexadecimal values will give you all the colors on the color. So if I say 000, I have black. If I say FFF, I have white. Okay. So if I say FFC1, don't mind me. This is one of my favorite colors. So you know, if I say FFC107, I get this. They call it. Don't mind my life. Okay. It's a yellow. It's not fully yellow. Okay, amber, yeah. So it's an amber yellow. Okay. So there are many ways around it. You know, you can, that's why when you use maybe some of these resources I will give to you at the end, they just give you the hex values. Okay. Because many of these new softwares tend to be able to convert your hex values to RGB, you know, or CSS values, or HSL values, or HSB values. Okay, so but the hex is already, you know, what you would need. You know, the rest is not really all that important. You can always use that when you're now talking on, or when you are designing with accessibility in mind, when you're using HSL or HSB, you know, which we'll talk about next. So HSB simply stands for hue, saturation, and brightness. Okay, so it's the degree of the color from 0 to 360, you know, why saturation and brightness are percentage values. Okay, so if we come back here, you know, and then we change to HSB, okay, so this is the hue, okay. So if I take the hue to maybe 90, you see it starts changing, okay. So the hue here is more or less the color itself, okay. Then the saturation is now how much of it you want, okay. Do you want it to be more, okay, 100 being the maximum, and then, you know, the saturation determines how, you know, light or how bright it is, you know. Then brightness still does the same, okay, but leaving it at the maximum 100 will give you the best value for that present color on the color wheel. So you can always play around with these values when you are more or less doing creating accessible color schemes. So accessible color schemes, we'll talk about that towards the end, as second to the final week. Okay. So how you want to like make your design work for people who also have visual problems or visual impairments. So the same thing applies for, I think this was 97 or so, yeah. So same thing applies for HSL, okay? So here now we can see the saturation is on max, but you know, we can now decide to make it lighter, or we can decide to make it darker, you know, whichever one works. Here we're now getting to a brownish, you know, yellow sort of feel. So that's majorly HSB and HSL. So hue, I think we've talked about hue. Hue is basically the definition of a color. If I say that color is red, it means the hue is red. Okay, that's the meaning for hue. Okay, and the value of hue is between 0 and 359. Okay, yeah, 359. Okay, then we have opacity. So opacity simply refers to the alpha value of a color. Okay, so sometimes people mistake opacity for, when I say tint, okay, yeah, tint and tones. Because now, okay, let me take this purple now. Now, if, remember I said if I go downwards, I'm toning. If I go upwards, I'm tinting, right? Okay, but if I come in here and I drag this slider, this is opacity here. So opacity determines how you know, the alpha value of a color, how transparent that color is. Okay, so more or less how you can differentiate is, I like the way Figma represents this, okay, because now in Figma, if I tint, if you look closely at this section, I don't know if I can zoom in on Figma, okay, nah. Okay, if you look closely here, this box that we have here is still fully colored, okay. If I bring it downwards, okay, the box is still fully colored. But when I begin to add opacity, you notice that the box changes, okay? It's not fully colored, you know? It's a good way to tell if you actually did a tint or a tone, or you used opacity, okay? Because sometimes people get confused about, you know, opacity, tint, and tones, okay? So, yeah, saturation, I think we've touched on saturation, you know, influences the level of purity or vividness of your color, okay, which was what we did in the HSL, you know, HSB and the HSL swatch. So tint, we've touched on tint as well, okay, you know, it's adding white or adding, you know, adding white to the base hue, so that way the color becomes sort of brighter, or, you know, and then tone is also to make it lower. So value is also referred to as lightness, okay, it refers to how light or how dark, you know, a color is. So it's still more or less the same thing. That's why I say some of them are related to each other, you know. They're just words that, you know, have been interchanged, sort of. Okay, so I think that would be like the end of today's class, okay? And these are tools for you that you can use. Color, I think Adobe Color allows you to create, you know, your swatch. Okay, let me see. So with Adobe Color, you more or less have the ability to just come in and start creating your color swatches using any of those techniques. Okay, so it can be my internet. No, so you can use the monochromatic scheme, you can use the analogous scheme, you can use any of those schemes, and then you can generate, you know, more or less like a color palette. You know, so like this now is an analogous scheme, you know, if you look closely. So you can say, oh, I want a monochromatic scheme, and it goes with colors. You can say you want triad, you want complementary, okay, you want split complementary, you want double split complementary, so there's even more. You want square, you want compound, okay? So, you know, and then you can choose what your base color would be like. And when you're done, you can always save or export your swatch, okay? So if I say I'm going monochromatic, I can now come in and say, okay, I like my FSU 107, for example, okay? And with this, I can create a monochromatic scheme that spans both, you know, light and dark, you know, and I can still adjust it whichever way I want. You know, I can tilt, you know, I can bring it downwards, you know, if I want something that is a little bit lighter. Okay, so this is a very, very great resource for creating, you know, color schemes. The other one is colors.cool or coolors. I think it's colors.cool. Sorry about it. So this is by far my favorite because it has other ways around it. You can actually import images and pick colors from images. You can generate yours, and there are ones that have already been generated. You know, so if you find a color scheme that someone has made, okay, and you sort of like it, so you know there are thousands of color schemes here. You know. Like, I like this, you know, I can decide to save this to my library and I can use this later on, okay? You know, this has almost a monochromatic feel, okay? Because, you know, if you look closely at all this, you know, this can be like a background. This can now be our pure white. This is a pure white, you know? And then, so this is a wonderful resource you can also use this is a wonderful example of a monochromatic scheme. Okay, these are just different shades of red. Okay, this is wonderful. Anyway, let me see. Don't mind me. I just saw this palette. Okay, you can actually download the palette. Okay, if you like it, so you can say, oh, you want it as an image, you want it as a PDF, and then you can bring it into your design software and use those colors. Okay, you know, so this is a wonderful resource. You can also create yours. When you click generate, you can create yours, you know, which is also a very, very nice view. So I can begin, I can see, but here you don't really have those, what do they call them? Those, you can't really use, most times it's, okay, wow, they did an update. Nice. Okay, so now they've included the schemes, which is nice. Okay, which is actually nice. Okay, so you can actually use those schemes. Before, you couldn't really use them, which means they did an update. Okay, you know, so that makes it better. That even makes it better. But it's a very nice resource that you can use. Okay, so we have Hali Pixels, then we have Flat UI Colors. You know, these are good resources you can actually use. I prefer Colors because I can see other palettes, you know. So sometimes it can save me the trouble of, you know, having to create palettes, you know. But there are projects where you just have to create your palettes, you know. So this also helps you. So I think that brings us to the end of today's class. So you have one assignment as usual. Okay, so you have to choose a color or colors for your product design, and you need to state why. Okay, so if it's an E3, why did you go with red? Okay, is it because it evokes this or it does that? You know, you don't really need to state why, okay, because you know, you're still new into colors and the likes, but you know, just pick a color for that project that you're already working on based on your design brief, and choose colors rather. Okay, and then you can use that within your UI. Okay, so that brings us to the end of today's class. Okay, so let me quickly unmute you guys. So if anyone has questions, they can ask. Okay. Okay, so Mayowa says, what of Pantone color? Okay. How do I describe Pantone? Pantone is another word. So Pantone, they are majorly like the consortium for colors. Okay. So they are the ones that assign color values. They create new colors. I think they are even the ones that create new colors and the light. So it's... just think of Pantone as the body that is in charge of colors worldwide. Okay, so when they create a color, for example, that color is assigned the X value as well as the Pantone value. Okay, and as I said, color is wide. Okay, because there are some Pantone colors that are never transported into maybe CMYK or RGB or X values. Okay, so it's unique for every color. Okay. So, Pantone has been something for the past 20 years where they do Pantone colors.
When
you check out some of those colors, they are Pantone exclusives. Also. So it's not, just think of them as the body in charge of color. Okay, so if you are trying to find more info on the color, the meaning of the color, the reason for that color, or the origins of that color and the likes, Pantone is your best bet. They offer materials, like they have these, their color catalogs and all of those things, which you can use. But there are tools online which you can also use to convert, I think, Pantone colors to X values and the likes. A Google search will be able to give you. No, I'm not heavily into Pantone, so it's there, but it's not. Well, just think of them as the almighty when it comes to color. So, do we have any other questions? I hope I was able to answer your question. Now, I'm not heavily invested into Pantone, so I don't really. Okay. Any other questions? Please ask your questions.
I'm good. we're good, sir.
Okay, Abib said, what if we are to pick? What are you picking exactly? Yeah, I would like to know what.
Can you hear me?
Okay.
Okay, let me just say it directly. Oh, so what if we are to generate colors from an image? So how do we go about that?
Oh, okay. There are tools. Okay, there's an app called HueSnap. Now, if you download the app on your phone, you can easily pick any image on your phone and it will give you the colors present in that image. Okay.
Okay.
And if you come to colors have Colors have, come in, let me see. Sorry, let me close out Zoom chat. Okay. So Colors have one, sorry. I don't know why this is acting up this way. This is very strange. But Colors have an option where you can upload an image. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Colors, I can hear you.
Yeah. Colors have an option where you can upload an image and then you now generate the swatch from it. And I think they even have a feature where you can increase the HS where you can now bring up the saturation and lightness or the brightness. So those are tools, but there are a lot. There are actually a lot of tools online. It's just a Google search, you know. You can just type color generator from image, you know, and Google would give you, you know, those resources. So do we have any other questions? Any other questions?
No, thank you.
Okay, so that's about it for today. I hope I've been able to explain color.
thank you very much.
So on Thursday, we'll talk on the other fundamentals like balance, proximity, and the likes. You know, it's just, they are short things, you know, so it's just things that you can integrate into your design so that your design is much more simple. No, I won't say simple, much more appreciated by the user. So that way the user is not really confused about the message you are trying to pass. You know, then after that on Saturday we'll have another live design session. And that's next week Saturday. We'll have another live design session where we'll now look at some advanced features in Figma, like creation of components, you know, creation of styles, universal styles and the likes. So that way you can work faster in Figma, and then we'll talk on some plugins you can use in Figma to speed up your workflow. Okay, so that'll be about it for today. So thank you guys for joining, and then please try to do your assignment too. Try to do your assignments. Okay. So take care, guys.